We're gonna follow our agenda tonight as it has been prepared. Anne Marie, was there an item on there that we were not gonna be able to get to?
Yes, sir. The, under the Public Works Committee, the old Hertford Road drainage improvement bids. We received the second quote this morning, but it's not apples to apples with the quote we got on Friday. And we wanna talk to the contractor who submitted the quote on Friday, Paul Woff, and just make sure everybody's bidding on the same thing. So we would like to get all of that squared away, and then we'll present it to you for action at the March 13th regular.
Okay. And with that one exception, we'll get started. Beginning with our Finance Committee, which is chaired by Councilman Dixon, please.
We have two things on tonight. First is the review of the restatement of accounts receivable in the 16-17 audit. I'm gonna let you handle that, Anne Marie.
Well, Steve, did you wanna?
Well, after we got the audit, and it was brought to our attention about this reduction of $739,000 in one fund and $128,000 in the other, I couldn't quite figure it out, and it seemed like the auditor couldn't, as to, I'm assuming this was actually written off 10 years ago, give or take?
No.
Okay, well, let me go just a little bit further, and then I'll let you tell me what happened there.
Okay.
According to the auditor, and in her findings, it was written off by account in 2007 or 2008. But we were not, I mean, it was never actually taken out of our audit. This is the part I can't understand. It was never taken out of the audit. It just kept being, according to her, and I went back and listened again to make sure that I was remembering what I thought I was hearing. And it was just pushed forward by our former auditor for the next 10 years. So I'm wrong, is that right? Which I've been wrong 1,000 times before.
Okay. Our new auditor restated the accounts receivables line item. And she told you all, and then she had met with me previously, that she could not get her arms around the formula or the calculation that the previous auditor used to determine how much revenue received in, you know, the next, after the June 30th year ended, that should be booked back to June 30th. And it mainly has to do with utility services, services rendered in June that we bill but don't collect until after June 30th. And she noted, you know, they spent a lot of time trying to understand where he was coming from, because it was going to be significant change to the balance sheet if they couldn't get their arms around it. So they investigated and talked, and they interviewed Jim Winston, and they interviewed the auditor that did the field work, and they said that our auditors now said that he used a calculation based on 48 days of receivables, which is an awfully long time. I mean, if you look at a calendar, and if it's 48 business days, that's September 1st. It was overstated, and that's what she said in the audit. Now, why he did that, you know, at the time in 08, we had just converted to a new billing system, and he did not have confidence in those numbers, and he did this calculation. So it's not as though it was a write-off. It was a restatement of how much money it was truly received after June 30 that needed to be booked back. And, you know, I went back and looked, Steve, and when you look at what he put in there in the audit for that year and look back at prior years, it was a big increase. Should I have caught it? Yes. Should, you know, the LGC didn't catch it. Electricity's reviews the audits. I mean, there was a lot of eyes on those audits back then around that time. And nobody saw that it was such a big difference.
But he kept carrying it forward, is that?
He used that formula. You know, he felt like that calculation was appropriate.
So was it a compounding number? Or was that singular number created way back then and then carried forward?
I think he used that calculation based on, you know, when they told me that he used 48 days.
So the number grew each year from what it was previous year? Or you don't know?
It changed, but I don't think it changed significantly.
Well, I think they did a good job of explaining it here. You know, they said during the fiscal year into June 30th, the town determined that certain accounts receivables were overstated as of June 30th. As a result, the net position of the electric fund has been reduced by $739,424, and the water and sewer fund has been reduced by $128,045. I thought that was well stated.
I think it is too, but what bothers me is this went on for 10 years and quite frankly, we didn't know about it. I mean, 10 years that they were just pushing monies forward and...
Well, for 10 years, he thought, you know, he was the auditor, he did the calculation, but the good thing now is that Donna has said, this is the number. They went, they dug through, and she said, this is the number, and we're going to be able to tie that number from the utility system into the general ledger. Is that correct, Virginia? We'll be able to tie the two together.
That's correct.
Yes.
But did we not, and she was not sure, help me if I'm wrong on this, Virginia, she was not sure if it didn't go back further than this. Is that correct? And how long was he our auditor?
I believe he came around 2004. I'd have to double check.
He's been our auditor for 13 years? 14 years?
I
think so. Is he an out-of-town auditor?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
But he did town, so nice.
Yeah.
Yeah, this was what he did. Anything else on that?
No need to push. Thank you.
Okay, and the second thing we have on is, I guess, what, two budget amendments that were contributions from the Bulkhead project. It was a credit of $15,125, and then that's what we spent. And then also the Forest Service grant, and that was a credit and a debit that worked out to zero. Is that right, Amory?
Yes, and Virginia prepared her first budget amendments, and you'll note that she's included a checkpoint so we make sure that everything's in balance, because that was one thing that happened with the audit that was discovered. So we put in a procedure to make sure we get it right.
So I guess we'll send that second one on to full council. That's all we have.
Okay, thank you. I'm moving next to the Administrative Committee, chaired by Councilman Biggs, please.
Yes, sir. We got several items on tonight. We got so many, we got two D's on here. But we're gonna move through these fairly quickly, I hope. The first one is the amendment to the agreement for the trolley. As y'all saw last week, the partnership between the town, Eatonton, state historic sites, some of that is going away, and now the trolley will be taken over by our friends across the street here. As you saw, Sharon Keeter has been doing this for quite a while, and she is retiring, I believe, the end of this month, and we'll be moving over with our friends there at the commission. And so what they would like for us to do is to
let the ticket sales go to the Edenton Historic Commission instead of the Cupola House and the state historic sites where they have been going. Craig, you all good with that?
For that, yes. I want to thank the people that got together quickly and came up with the decision they did. Very well done.
Yuana, any comments at all? But we do thank you for being here tonight.
Well, thank you. And this, as I told you coming in, it's one of the few things I've been involved in all these many years in Edenton, where there's absolutely unanimous agreement that this trolley is so important to the town of Edenton. And not the Historic Commission, not the Cupola House Association, but the whole town, everybody in this town. And, you know, when we got the news that the state was not going to be funding an interpreter, Jennifer with Destination Downtown, Nancy with the Tourism Development Authority, the Cupola House Association, all of us just unanimously said, we have got to do something because we have to have that. And so this came about, and it could not have come about if it were not for the town of Edenton. Going ahead and continuing the practice that it has in the past as far as the expenses with the trolley. So it really is a partnership that is just in the best interest of everybody involved.
And by the way, you have a great driver, too.
Oh, he's terrific, yeah.
He does more than drive. He is Mr. Congeniality. I greet him on the trolley, and he's waving, and he's pulling that bell.
Yeah, he rings that bell. All the tourists wave.
Well, encourage all your friends and neighbors and acquaintances to donate to the Edenton Historical Commission to keep this going, because this is a sort of a stretch for the commission to take this on.
Something we had not planned on by any means, but somehow we'll make it work.
We're lucky to have Chris's leadership in that position.
Sure.
Well, thank you, sir.
Yes.
Thank you. All right, well, we'll send that on to full council if that's all right. Item B, resolution requesting that Chowan County Planning Regulations of the development powers with the town's ETJ. As y'all know, Apex Clean Energy is on the move trying to put up some windmills, but there's anybody okay with
that? Not your gun.
That was not your gun.
They are requesting that the development powers be pushed over to the county. I understand that there is a statute for that we can turn it over to the county, and it is within our ETJ, but it is right on the edge of it. So, Anne-Marie, you got this up, something you want to show us? Or?
Just want, really, you all received the map in your packet, but for the public, point out where the lots are that are in the town's ETJ, here, here, and here. This black line is the boundary of the 1 mile extraterritorial jurisdiction, which the town has zoning powers and land use development authority over. And you all have done this a couple times for situations where projects, where you have agreed to give up zoning power and transfer that to the county. And the developer is asking for the transfer because otherwise they would have to make two requests. You know, the town would have to be reviewing the requests for these properties, but then the county would be reviewing where the distribution line or the overhead lines go all the way up to the actual site. And we think it makes sense from a consistency standpoint to have the same governing body that reviewed the original project to review this, and it might be less confusing for the public as well.
That makes a lot of sense.
And this is just for them to put the lines into the station anyhow?
Correct. There'd be a, they would have to build, or their plan is to build a switching station somewhere here.
Right.
And then the overhead lines go to the actual facilities.
So one governing body, and that would be the county.
What about buffer? I mean, you know, we do better on buffers and things like that than any other. I mean, it makes me nervous to give up anything to the county as far as, you know, planning ability. I mean, I will just tell you that. I mean,
there's already, correct me if I'm wrong, I think there's already two substations out there.
Yeah.
That are.
That's why they have to be, right, they have to be close. They're going to actually connect the switching station to the.
So,
is it the Dominion station, Don?
It would be eventually, yes.
Isn't most of it in the woods, anyway?
It's all rural area out there.
Don?
Agricultural land or forested land, yeah.
And that's one little home near the substation out there, but that's the only house I know.
I believe that's correct. On the other side of the railroad tracks, I think.
Okay. On substation road.
On substation.
Substation road.
Yeah.
It makes sense to have the one governing body, that being the county. The other ones have started. I mean, they've been working on this for how many years now?
And we're just giving that up for this one project, right?
Yeah. That's it.
Yes.
That's it. Still my soul. Could we, so this is just an article, could we get something by the next meeting to say what there, if there's a difference between the two requirements, any type of...
We can do that. We can see if there are requirements. Yeah. And then we can actually, Elizabeth and I can go out and do a site visit, and we can look at the land and maybe give you a report, some photos of what it looks like.
All right. That'd be great.
Because it is right along the railroad tracks. So. Okay?
You okay to send that on to the full council?
Okay.
Council would do. The next item on the agenda, Councilman Miller and I were talking about this one night, and what we'd like to request is that our packets go out now, just like our packet came out late Friday this particular time. I probably didn't see it till early Saturday. And sometimes it, maybe not in this particular case, but sometimes it makes a hardship when we get the packet on Friday. And you got to sit here on Monday night. If you're out of town for the weekend, and you...
It doesn't give us much of a window.
It doesn't.
To do any research, to have discussions with people, or to do any site visits. It's not every agenda item, but there's certain agenda items that you would need to hold some discussions.
And what we, the administrative committee, would like to propose and send to full council for a vote is that the agenda packet come out no later than 5 o'clock on Wednesday before our following meeting instead of coming out on Friday. That would give you a little extra time to maybe prepare some things.
Can I ask you a quick question? What about stuff that comes in after that?
We just have a wait.
That's all I've been to get the latest.
Well, I mean, we can still get it, but it doesn't. I don't know that 2 days is going to matter on the agenda. I wouldn't think. I would hope not. You know, if something does come up, maybe she can send it out on Fridays or whatever and say this is something that really needs to be talked about. But
I'll make a comment. To what Sambo said, in my opinion, things do come in after Wednesday that can be dealt with in a timely manner. And I don't know, just for the sake of research, or another day or two, a day, 2.5 days, not 2.5 days, you said 5 o'clock. I can't see where it's been a burden upon this
governing body in the past, and I'm just wondering why it needs to be changed if it's just for an occasional sort of item that perhaps would require a little bit of research, then I would say then it's incumbent upon us to find the time to do it. That's my opinion, but anyway, thank you.
Yes, in a time.
I think in the case, I was telling Emery, in the case of the Airbnb issue, and I really wanted to talk with the inn owners, innkeepers, and really what I did that particular, I happened to be here that weekend, so that Sunday, I went out and talked to them about the Airbnb issue, and you know, it took quite a bit of some time Sunday. But you, like Steve says, you may be gone for the weekend. You may have plans or something.
Well, there also, if I may, there have also been numerous times in my tenure here where an item gets to full council and it's at that time that we discover that it's not ready for vote. In that case, it's sent back to committee again for another round, which would address, I think, what you all are expressing. But again, I guess I'm a creature of habit at this stage of the game.
Steve, I'm not on your committee. Can I,
absolutely.
It seems to me that it would put more of a pressure on staff, too, to get it out 2 days earlier. And as the mayor said, you know, we've been getting it on Friday all this time, and it really hasn't created a problem that I know of to getting out this time. And it just seems to me that we would have to be piecemealing it if we get it out on Wednesday afternoon, and then some more items or something comes up between then and Friday, she's got to send out an addendum to that. It just appears to me that it's putting more work on staff, but just one man's opinion.
Yes, sir. Well, we'll send it on and see where it goes.
How about
that? Okay. That all right? Okay. All right. Also, sale of surplus property that we have acquired that is on Oakham Street in the neighborhood, neighborhood redevelopment zone. In your packet, there are actually two houses. One of them was for $30,000. And the other one was for $15,500 that a local appraiser did for us. Elizabeth has, you know, drafted a media release, like the green light to get started on this. So, you know, we wanted to go ahead and get started on this to move these properties as quick as we can and get someone in them. And,
I wish we could do something like
up.
This every month. We would have. I think about the next 5 years, we have pretty good.
Can we put in here that we're going to let the Eden Historical Commission have preservation covenants over these with a rehabilitation schedule? Because what we don't want to happen is if somebody buys it then doesn't fix it up, then we're right back where we started. And so that's. The first one was St. John's Church that went forward that they did, because it used to cost $5,000 a piece to have them with Preservation North Carolina, and the commission is all, you know, excited about the redevelopment zones anyway. I think they'd be good people to hold a good organization to hold the covenants, and then you have some way to make the person do the things that you want them to do. Because, you know, we could be right back where we started. So we sell this thing out without any kind of rehabilitation schedule, any of that kind of stuff. Then, you know, we haven't done anything. And I don't know whether that needs to go into the sale notice or not, but I think it probably does.
I think it probably does. I would want to talk with Hood or Ben about what we would need to include in our sale notice to kind of disclose that that's part of what they're buying into.
Yeah.
No problem with that. You correct. If you want to check with Hood on, excuse me, go ahead, Mike.
No, I just have a question. Elizabeth, there's nothing in the ordinance now that
There's no timeline for these things to get started in the ordinance as it's written?
I don't think so.
Really?
No, but I think I'll have to go back and look at our
That's
notes.
That's too speculative.
And our discussions. I'm not sure, and this was before Elizabeth joined us, if we didn't talk about requiring them to submit some sort of pre-qualification to make sure that they had the wherewithal to be able to afford or finance the redevelopment. Kind of like what the Mill Village did when they sold those properties.
Well, and they are, that's what they have. They had a redevelopment. I mean, they had a schedule that they had to do the fix up. So, you know, something sits for 2 years and you can get it back easier. Yeah. So, you know, that it's exactly what they did on the mill.
And it all depends on what your purpose is. You know, if you just want to sell it to someone and they'll put it in an envelope and try to flip it to the next person, then we haven't, as Sambo said, we haven't made any progress.
Yeah.
It looks like the house at 123 East Gale would probably be demolished.
No.
Hope
not.
Okay, I was just wondering.
That was part of what they're doing. It. They didn't want it demolished.
They wanted more. Pretty bad shape.
Yeah, true.
It needs significant work. It does.
All right, well, if you want to check with Hood on that and see how you got to advertise it, we'll send that on to full council also. And the final thing that we've got tonight is the proposal for the video services for the East Gale Street Neighborhood Preservation Grant. Elizabeth, thank you for handling that for us, of course, and under your recommendation, it was Mr. Hood that from the Williamsburg area that you consider to be the best, and if you're good with that, we will send that on the full council also to take your recommendation on that and go with Mr. Hood. Mayor, that takes care of us.
Thank you very much. All right, and finally this evening, our Public Works Committee is going to meet. And that's chaired by Councilman Stallion, please.
Thank you, Mayor. We had two items on the list tonight, but now it's narrowed down to we only have one. Excuse me, and that was the resolution for the request from Destination Downtown Edenton for the Boogie on Broad. That's going to be held on Friday, April the 20th. And we have heretofore granted them permission to sell beer and wine in the designated area. We usually have the police, and the police do a good job of policing that. And we have not had any problems for the last several years. So I would suggest that we, and Sambo, you're the only one here that's on my committee, so if that's all right, you will send it for us.
Okay, and I say it every time, we're so lucky to have Jennifer for what she does and
don't
all the people that help her. So,
Jennifer, it is a fun evening.
It is.
It's really good to get all the socioeconomic groups and one together and just out there having a great time. The bands have been terrific, and thank you for what you do and your board and the police and your volunteers.
Do I need to do my presentation?
You worked on it.
No, thank you. I'll share quickly. I have a couple of slides.
I'm sorry, Jennifer.
No, that's okay.
I didn't realize you could do a presentation.
No, that's okay.
I apologize for that.
Oh, no. I appreciate the kind words, and thank you all for allowing me to come before you and tell you a little bit about Boogie on Broad this year. We have our naming sponsors for 2018. It's Albemarle Bank and Fire Ford again. We appreciate their support, and we're excited it's going to be Friday, April 20th, which coincides with Easels in the Garden. We try to get people that come on the tour to stay and put heads in beds, as Nancy likes to say, and help the local economy as much as we can. The Catalinas will be playing. They're a great beach music band, and we will be celebrating North Carolina Craft Beer Month as well. And this is a picture from last year. Y'all, this event has just grown and grown and grown. And I took this picture and
We have really no way of counting exactly how many people come because people come and go, but I think this just shows all ages, everyone outside having a great time, and of course, a lot of that is weather permitting. So everybody cross your fingers. It takes tons of volunteers. This is a picture of a few of our volunteers that evening. I think last year we had around 40 volunteers for that event. It really does take most of the village, from public works to fire, EMS, the police, everyone chips in, and obviously citizens as well. It is family friendly. That little girl was my favorite. She danced all night. A couple of these are mine, but I just loved this picture and had to include it. And then this shows the area in yellow where we are proposing that we serve, and this is where we have served in the past. The area in green is a private lot owned by Admiral Bank and rented by Crestwell Furniture, and we've used that before as well. So this is the area in question as far as serving. And the Edenton Police Department is really good about helping us kind of barricade the areas so that people know they can't leave with a drink. But it's worked out beautifully in the past. But people have really respected the boundaries and each other.
And you're having that along with the Easels in the garden?
Yes.
That particular Friday?
Yes, it's every other year. We're either with Pilgrimage or Easels.
I've heard tourists comment. Yeah, your community really gets along well together. That's what we do this once a year.
Well, it is nice. I had one couple say that they bought a house and decided to retire here because they happened to show up during Boogie on Broad. And I don't know if they thought every weekend was like that. But they have actually become some great volunteers. So I thought that spoke a lot for the event as well. But I'm happy to answer any questions you may have.
Just continue the great work.
Thank y'all.
Wish we had it twice a year.
Good job, Jennifer. Thank you very much. And so, Samuel, I believe we've already agreed to send out.
Yeah.
And that's all we have, man.
Jennifer, twice a year costs a lot of money, doesn't it?
Thank you. Yes.
Yeah. And four times a year costs a whole lot of money.
Yeah. It's very expensive.
I told Jennifer and my fellow board members at the Destination Downtown meeting most recent that I was in high school and we booked the Catalinas for the day.
You have the grandchildren playing there?
Yeah. So, they were good.
Yeah. So were the Ambers.
All right. Well, with that, we have completed our agenda for tonight. Thank all of you for coming and participating. And we will see you next time at our March Council meeting. We adjourn.